three PhD students here today who are going to be presenting their work, and that's been an integral part of the network, the idea that we're going to be working with PhD students, hopefully publishing with our PhD students as the network draws to a close, and looking to build on sharing that knowledge beyond the kind of key people in the network. So I'm really pleased that you three are here today, and I'm sure you'll make a really important contribution to the network. So thank you all for being here, and thank you for hosting us, Pranjali.
To begin with, a bit of recapitulation very briefly. The concept of public good, private good began with Paul Samuelson's 1954 article. And if we go strictly by his definition, then there's a clear demarcation between public good and private good. Public good is a clear case of market failure, so the state has to provide. Private good would be delivered by the private sector within a market setup. But gradually, the distinction has been found to be really untenable, is blurred, because we see an increasing private participation.
And we don't seem to have, especially in the public sector, the capacity to understand and to write contracts that would take care of this. We should have automatic triggers that without discretion, you would know when arbitration is required, when renegotiation is required, and how exactly are we going to value and share risks.
Discussion is on PPP, so obviously the whole idea is the policy context. We are looking for a right role of the state rather than of the private sector. At least in housing, because it's not exactly what water would mean or what health would mean or education would mean. To some extent, housing is indeed a private good achieved by the household.
So first, very briefly, if we want to look at the trajectory of the World Bank's involvement in housing policy, then we see that the World Bank made an entry into housing and urban development, was called shelter at the time, in the early 1970s. This was under the leadership of the then World Bank President McNamara, who was seeking to reorient the kind of the focus of the bank.
So the first housing policy in India came in 1994. But after that, there has been a national housing policy in 1998. There is an urban housing and habitat policy which came up in 2005. Various state governments came up with their own state housing policies from 2006 to 2008. That has then been followed by affordable housing policies at a national level, then at a state level. We now also have a rental housing policy.
Sri Parambur, Chennai, if you look at the outskirts of Chennai, you know, the big industries have come up, the village houses are getting converted into PG accommodations. Gurgaon is really not, the call center employees are not really living in those big gated communities, but they are living in the villages, which are kind of transforming into chawl-like apartments. Bombay created call centers, did not succeed, was not very successful, did not multiply, did not grow, particularly because there is no housing which is complementing to call centers.
Right to water of slum dwellers cannot be considered at par with the legal options. So how can you really create differential rights? I mean, right is right. I mean, human right to water is right. Fine. But court itself is saying that this right is not at par with that right. And on one hand, you talk about right to water and universal access. So very interestingly, these two incidences, one interpreting 135 LPCD through a public-private partnership as right and legitimizing it. Second, you are saying that these two rights are not at par. Really trying to change our understanding, because this ruling has implications that you can provide water through water ATMs.
And one of the reasons why poorer households pay much more for water, even within households that only rely on piped water supply, is simply because of the increasing block tariff. Right? Because water is supplied to a building and not to an individual household.
Something that we need to talk, we need to revisit in terms of the role of the state, particularly in this sort of experiment. What really state is and how do we understand it?
if there is a, you know, tribal project coming into forest areas, you know, there is the state and the World Bank who may be kind of, you know, responsibility holders, but the tribals has rights holders. So can we disaggregate these rules is one question, which will then kind of bring us, you know, what is state, what is society.
Any kind, so it's really one step forward, two steps backward for those who are actually demanding more and more accountability on the part of the state. And I think that this is, these are some of the issues I thought, you know, are really extremely important to discuss.
In the context of school education, it becomes important because on the basis of categorization of merit code, lot many countries have actually made a rationale for the support of state for providing education.
Simply with the use of indicators to calculate the performance scores of the institutions, it is pushing public-private partnerships and privatization as a quality indicator.
I think we need to have a particular study. This might be beyond this literature review, but I think India, because of the SC, ST, OBC, so scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, other backward classes, these different groups, how the private sector has affected these different categories.
We have to interrogate what does publicness mean, and I think we don't have a common, I think there will be very many varied understandings of what constitutes the public.
We question the rationale for existence of non-profit, in quotes, hospitals at the tertiary level. So considerable work needs to be done for accountability, creating regulatory mechanisms which are actually missing, which come up once in a while but completely missing for such collaborations and partnerships. So do these institutions finally deserve the subsidies that they're getting and tax exemptions for their work?
And now there's a new term which is being picked up by all about strategic purchasing, mm-hmm. and it was quite debated heavily because some people at the conference felt that it was a good way. Not really sure because it's not. There's no evidence that even better planning will actually ensure that the private sector will provide.
Equity of, and universal health care, these are the issues which have to be addressed through PPP, so how do we do that?
Today's discussion on four very important sectors, housing, water, education and health. And I must thank all the participants who have come such a short notice. And all of you who are here, particularly the people who are the panelists of the different panels, like Amita, Darshini Madhavi, Mahadeviya, Eliza, Prasad, Shetri, and Abhay Shetri, who have chaired the urban the housing session. Also, thanks to our panelists in the water session, NC Narayanan, Dupak Mandan, Suhas Vasme, and of course our own Pranjal. Pranjal deserves a separate thanks. Also thank to the invitees in the education session, Himon, Simrat, Nandini Manjarekar for chairing the session, Anupam Pachodi, Shomenda. Again, thanks once again, Marie. Also for the health panel, I thank Jasmine, Ramabaru, Madhuriman, and